Greetings. This is part two in a series about the Book of Life. Let's keep looking at the scriptures that refer to the Book of Life. One of the verses we already covered was Revelation 3:5. Like them, the one who is victorious will be dressed in white, and I will never blot out his name from the Book of Life, but I will confess his name before my Father and his angels. In fact, my entire interest in this topic arose from this concept, to be blotted out of the Book of Life. If you are a Calvinist, allow your mind to linger on this concept. As a Calvinist, it would seem consistent to think those written in the Book of Life are the elect, those predestined for heaven. Where in Tulip would it allow for the elect to lose that election, for their name to be removed from the list of the elect? Exodus 32:33, And the Lord said unto Moses, Whoever has sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book. Another example that God will blot out a name that must already be in there. He does say, Whoever has sinned against me. Psalm 9, verse 5. You have rebuked the nations. You have destroyed the wicked. You have erased their name forever and ever. But this does not specifically mention the Book of Life. Exodus 17:14. Then the Lord said to Moses, Write this on a scroll as a reminder and recite it to Joshua, because I will utterly blot out the memory of Amalek from under heaven. Okay, this makes me chuckle. Doesn't the reminder of the removal of Amalek from memory just bring it back into our memory? Oh, I'm sure one could torture language and try and invent rationales to defend this. But that's not my job to guard over God's word, to defend it from attack and insult. Nor does Jehovah God attempt to ascribe credentials for himself with claims of perfect logical consistency. Like I said, it just makes me giggle because somebody probably does get wrapped around the axle on that verse. Then the Lord said to Moses, Write this in a scroll as a reminder, and recite it to Joshua, because I will utterly blot out the memory of Amalek from under heaven. But it is not specifically involving the Book of Life. The search for blot turned this up. Deuteronomy 29:20. The Lord will never be willing to forgive him. Instead, his anger and jealousy will burn against that man, and every curse written in this book will fall upon him. The Lord will blot out his name from under heaven. Again, not specifically mentioning the Book of Life. The search for the word blot turned it up. But let's check the context to see the cause of this condemnation and erasure. Deuteronomy 29:10. All of you are standing today before the Lord your God, your leaders of tribes, elders, officials, and all the men of Israel, your children and wives, and the foreigners in your camps, who cut your wood and draw your water. Okay, everybody. So that you may enter into the covenant of the Lord your God, which he is making with you today, and into his oath. And so that he may establish you today as his people, and he may be your God as he promised you, and as he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. This is entering into the covenant at a location called Moab. I am making this covenant and this oath not only with you, but also with those who are standing here with us today in the presence of the Lord your God, as well as those who are not here today. By mentioning here, God mentions location. By mentioning today, God includes time. So this is a far-reaching covenant in both location and potentially time. For you yourselves know how we lived in the land of Egypt, and how we passed through the nations on the way here. You saw the abominations and idols among them, made of wood and stone and silver and gold. Make sure there is no man or woman, clan or tribe among you today whose heart turns away from the Lord our God to go and worship the gods of those nations. Make sure there is no root among you that bears such poisonous and bitter fruit. Often God's commands and actions are to prevent future issues. Prevent or remove the root, and there will not be a plant later with poisonous and bitter fruit. Because when such a person hears the words of this oath, he invokes a blessing on himself, saying, I will have peace, even though I walk in the stubbornness of my own heart. This will bring disaster on the watered land as well as the dry. The Lord will never be willing to forgive him. Instead, his anger and jealousy will burn against that man, and every curse written in this book will fall upon him. The Lord will blot out his name from under heaven and single him out from all the tribes of Israel for disaster, according to all the curses of the covenant written in this book of the law. So this specifically is about this covenant made in Moab, and also does not mention the book of life. Moving on. Revelation 13:8. I'm going to save this for last because it has an interesting twist. Revelation 20:12. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne. And there were open books, and one of them was the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their deeds, as recorded in the books. The book of life is one of many books. The dead were judged according to their deeds. Hold up a minute. I thought we were forgiven. I thought the handwriting of the notes against us was erased. Colossians 2:13. And you, being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, notice, this is Gentiles he's talking to, has he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us. Curious, the ordinances. Maybe the list of infractions. Probably nothing, but I find that wording peculiar. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and there were open books, and one of them was the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their deeds, as recorded in the books. So the book of life is involved in this judgment phase. For context, this is now the great white throne judgment, after the millennium. Revelation 20, verse 7. And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison. This is after the 1,000 years, the millennium, and Satan shall go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, the number of whom is as the sand of the sea. And they went up on the breadth of the earth, and compassed the camp of the saints about, and the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven, and devoured them. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night, forever and ever. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. Next we get to the text of interest. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. We have the books, and then mention of the Book of Life. As I read this, the Book of Life seems separate from the books used to judge at this point. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works. I never really paid attention to this before. Those in hell are fetched from hell to then be judged. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. So in this passage, the book of life appears to be used as the final filter to determine who is cast into the lake of fire. Anyone to be blotted out has already been blotted out. That's all the references to the Book of Life I can find, save one. Revelation 13:8. I mentioned this earlier, and I've saved it until last because there appears to be two schools of thought regarding its translation. There is an important phrase in this verse, "from the foundation of the world." There are two other subjects in the sentence that are important. The Lamb of God who was slain, and people whose names are or are not written in the Book of Life. It was some years ago that I first ran across the situation I am about to describe. School 1 associates the phrase "foundation of the world" with the Lamb who was slain. "And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world." That's the King James. That has a very clear implication that Jesus was considered slain from before God created the world. All inhabitants of the earth will worship the beast, all whose names have not been written in the Lamb's Book of Life, the Lamb who was slain from the creation of the world. That's the New International Version. This has a very clear meaning that Jesus was slain from before God created the world. And all the people who belong to this world worship the beast. They are the ones whose names were not written in the Book of Life that belongs to the Lamb who was slaughtered before the world was made. That's the New Living Translation. Again, a very clear implication that Jesus was considered slaughtered before God created the world, or before the world was made. School 2 associates the phrase "foundation of the world" with the presence of names in the Book of Life. "And all who dwell on the earth will worship it, everyone whose name has not been written before the foundation of the world in the Book of Life of the Lamb who was slain." That's the English Standard Version. "And all who dwell on the earth will worship the beast, all whose names have not been written from the foundation of the world in the Book of Life belonging to the Lamb who was slain." That's the Berean Study Bible. I have a potential problem with this school of thought because it is so Calvinistic in alignment. But I really respect the Berean Study Bible. I find it accurate and clear for the majority of times I use it. Okay, all, save this one case. So how do we resolve this contention between School 1 and School 2? Rock, paper, scissors. School 2 goes first? Well, fun though that might be, I think it more scholarly to look at the original Greek. I'm going to use a screen capture of a portion of Revelation 13:8 from BibleHub.com. I hope you can read this. If not, you can go to BibleHub.com to do your own viewing. These are the three phrases of interest from the verse. "Have been written, the names of them, in the Book of Life." This section has of the lamb having been slain, and the final section from the founding of the world. Seeing the phrases in position, the association seems obvious.
You're to speak, God does not.
So I am prone to accept translation from School 1 that Jesus, the Lamb of God, was predestined to be slain by the plan of God, which leaves the usage of Book of Life in Revelation 13:8 as simply the filter being used. I do not think those in School 2 are intentionally perpetrating a deception. Dr. James White, who I greatly respect, is a Calvinist who participated in the New International Version. The New International Version was the second example I provided from School of Thought number 1. Whether subliminal or subconscious, there is a topic regarding the Book of Life which none of these scriptures cover. When are names added to the Book of Life? All the references I found were from a search of blot. So I did a search for add book, but found nothing. That remains a hanging question. But much less important than rejoicing our name is in the Book of Life, of the Lamb, slain by the plan of God from the founding of the world. Perhaps that contributed to the translators' willingness to associate the phrasing the way they did in School 2. The topic that if no names are ever added, they must have been there from the beginning. There is certainly scripture supporting that God's will is for all mankind to be saved. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. 1 Timothy 2:3 and 4, for this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. That's his will, his desire, his purpose, his plan, his intent, to have all men be saved. So with no clear statement when names are added to the Book of Life, a conjecture that they begin there is as supported as any other claim. But I don't think either position can be dogmatically asserted. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And may you rejoice that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Amen.